Good morning, everyone, and a warm welcome to anyone joining us for a service of morning prayer from St. Mary's Anglican Church in Clarenville. It's a pleasure to be here. I am the deacon at the church, the Reverend Sheila Sevier. As you can see, the Reverend Keith Denman is missing. Not really. He and his good wife Beverly are relaxing in some beautiful spot, enjoying a staycation. So Reverend Keith, as you said often, we hope that you got your comfy slippers on and settle down to tune in this service. Today we have licensed lay minister Iris Phillips helping with the service, and a big thank you to her and to Paul Tilley, our technical guy, who's been so supportive all through COVID. Our music today is provided by Charlene Solomon. Our service is taken from the Book of Alternative Services. It is the 10th Sunday after Pentecost. I pray that we will receive a blessing today through the prayers and the singing and God's holy word. We begin with our opening hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy. Is the bold type. You send forth your spirit, O Lord, you renew the face of the earth.
You send forth your spirit, O Lord, you renew the face of the earth.
O Lord, how manifold are your works. In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures.
You renew the face of the earth.
All of them look to you to give them their food in due season.
You renew the face of the earth.
You give it to them, they gather it. You open your hand, and they are filled with good things.
You renew the face of the earth.
May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in all his works.
You renew the face of the earth.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
You send forth your spirit, O Lord. You renew the face of the earth.
And now we move to our penitential rite, found on page 45. Penitential rite on page 45. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare to worship Almighty God, let us with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins that we have made obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we move to page 47. Lord, open our lips,
and our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory
to the Father, and to the Son,
and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
For our canticle this morning, we will be using number 3, Song of Thanksgiving, found on page 76. Together we sing.
Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my Savior. Therefore you shall draw water with rejoicing from the springs of salvation. And on that day you shall say, give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make his deeds known among the peoples. See that they remember that his name is exalted. Sing the praises of the Lord, for he has done great things, and this is known in all the world. Cry loud, inhabitants of Zion. Ring out your joy, for the great one in the midst of you is the Holy One of Israel.
And now we will move to have our proclamation of the word.
The first reading is taken from Genesis chapter 37, reading selected verses. Jacob settled in the land where his father had lived as an alien, the land of Canaan. This is the story of the family of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding the flock with his brothers. He was a helper to the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives, and Joseph brought a bad report of them to their father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any other of his children, because he was a son of his old age, and he had made him a long robe with sleeves. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Now his brothers went to pasture their father's flock near Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem? Come, I will send you to them. He answered, here I am. So he said to him, go now, see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring word back to me. So he sent him from the valley of Hebron. He came to Shechem, and a man found him wandering in the fields. The man asked him, what are you seeking? I am seeking my brothers, he said. Tell me, please, where are they pasturing the flock? The man said, they have gone away, for I heard them say, let us go to Dothan. So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him from a distance, and before he came near to them, they conspired to kill him. They said to one another, here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we shall say that a wild animal has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams. But when Reuben heard it, he delivered him out of their hands, saying, let us not take his life, Reuben said to them, "Shed no blood. Throw him into this pit here in the wilderness, but lay no hand on him, that he might rescue him out of their hand and restore him to his father." So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the long robe with sleeves that he wore. And they took him and threw him into a pit. The pit was empty. There was no water in it. Then they sat down to eat. And looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with their camels carrying gum, balm, and resin on their way to carry it down to Egypt. Then Judah said to his brothers, "What profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, for he is our brother, our own flesh." And his brothers agreed. When some Midianite traders passed by, they drew Joseph up, lifting him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they took Joseph to Egypt. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm for this morning is Psalm 105, found on page 845 of the Book of Alternative Services. We'll pray this morning verses 1 through 6 and 16 to 22. And we'll do the prayer at the end of page 848. We'll pray the psalm this morning together. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, and speak of all his marvelous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Search for the Lord and his strength. Continually seek his face. Remember the marvels he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. O offspring of Abraham, his servant, O children of Jacob, his chosen. Then he called for a famine in the land and destroyed the supply of bread. He sent a man before them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. They bruised his feet in fetters, his neck they put in an iron collar, until his prediction came to pass. The word of the Lord tested him. The king sent and released him. The ruler of the people set him free. He set him as a master over his household, as a ruler over all his possessions, to instruct his princes according to his will, and to teach his elders wisdom. Alleluia. Let us pray. God of our salvation, through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, you have fulfilled your promise to our ancestors in the faith to redeem the world from slavery and to lead us into the promised land. Grant us living water from the rock and bread from heaven, that we may survive our desert pilgrimage and praise you forever. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. The second reading this morning is taken from Romans chapter 10, reading verses 5 through 15. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, "Do not say in your heart, 'Who will ascend into heaven?' that is, to bring Christ down. Or, 'Who will descend into the abyss?' that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is, the word of faith. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, 'No one who believes in him will be put to shame.' For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, 'How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news.'" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our gradual hymn, taken from the praise book, Here I Am. While he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." and they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed a strong wind, he became frightened and beginning to sink. He cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You have little faith. Why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise
to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. May the words of my lips and the meditation of all of our hearts be now and always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. Today's gospel picks up where it left off last week. It had been a very exhausting but powerful day for Jesus and his disciples. First, they learned that their friend John the Baptist had been beheaded. Jesus decides to withdraw in a boat and go to a deserted place. It doesn't happen. Instead, he is chased along the shore by a very needy crowd and spends his day healing the sick. At the end of it, he is faced with a very hungry crowd. The disciples suggest sending them away to buy their own food, but Jesus is not satisfied with that suggestion. Instead, he has compassion on them, and as a result, the disciples witness the impossible feeding of more than 5,000 with just a few fish and loaves. That was last week's. Today, we pick up the story where the meal is over, and just prior to dismissing the crowd, Jesus sends the disciples by boat back to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. Finally, alone in the evening, Jesus seeks solitude and a time to pray. Meanwhile, night begins to fall, and the disciples are still on the lake. The winds come up, and the waves come crashing against the boat. In the dawn of the morning, Jesus decides to join the disciples in their boat. Unimpaired by limitations, he takes a shortcut across the water. Much can be made of this move on Jesus' part, for it is truly a significant revelation of power for him to do this. His followers had witnessed mostly healings up to this point, although there was a changing of water into wine at the marriage in Canaan, and just a few hours previous, the feeding of many with little. There is no explanation as to why he defies the laws of nature in this way, but the disciples get to witness God's sovereignty over the sea. Maybe he feels the disciples are ready to see just how limitless the Son of God really is. Or Jesus saw the need to be in person to calm their fears in the rough waters, although no one is calling out to him to come. In any case, the disciples are startled to see a figure walking on the water. They cannot make sense of what they're seeing, although it is their friend. We could easily ask, what prevents them from recognizing Jesus for who he really is? They spent months traveling and being taught by him. There are similar examples in the Bible. What prevented the two walking on the road to Emmaus from first recognizing Jesus? Or why does Mary Magdalene mistake Jesus for a gardener outside his tomb? And we could ask ourselves the same question. What is it that often keeps us from seeing God's presence among us? We read in Matthew 28:20, Jesus seeks us and is present with us even to the end of age. Maybe it is our anxieties, confusion, fears, and our failure to anticipate miracles. Such feelings can cause us to miss those moments of grace surrounding us. Jesus comes at the unexpected hour in unusual burning bush ways, like on the water, or to Jacob in an unusual dream at a place Jacob called Bethel. Fearfully, the disciples cry out, thinking it is a ghost, not Jesus, they say, possibly a spirit from the deep. It seems to be a central part of our human nature to blind ourselves to the arrival of the Holy in those anxious and confusing moments. But contrary to our blindness, it seems to be a central aspect of God's character to stand calmly with a word of comfort to soothe us in such moments as we see when Jesus speaks. Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid. Once Jesus identifies himself, Peter comes alive and ready to act in faith. He needs to hear just another little bit of reassurance that he is encountering the Holy. Peter speaks out in faith. Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. He gets that bit of his reassurance from Jesus in one simple word, come. We all need a bit of reassurance to encourage us to action from time to time. In our ministries, I remember quite a few years back, the rector in this church surprised me one Sunday by inviting me to become a Eucharistic minister. I never thought that opportunity would ever come my way. It was such an honor to be asked. But through the rector's kind words and encouragement, I stepped out in faith and God gave me what I needed to begin. Jesus speaks to us to be encouraging to others and to use the same word to invite others to come and know Christ. In St. John's Gospel, we see Jesus inviting two of John's followers, and he says, come and see. Given Peter's nature and hearing the word come, he's out of the boat and running to greet the Lord. Just for a moment, just a split second, his faith is stronger than his doubt. As long as Peter is focused on Jesus, everything is okay. But then the world, the wind, memory, and fear crush in on him, and he begins to sink. Lord, save me, he cries. Have you ever felt like Peter, out of control and drowning? As humans, it is difficult to avoid such moments. Waves beat against all of us from time to time. Sometimes we feel as though we are in over our heads or bitten out more than we can chew. During such times, it becomes easy to drown in sorrow and depression. It can happen in our careers, in raising our families, or in our ministries. It may be a bad relationship that takes all of our energy, or a large debt that we cannot pay. It may be sickness or the passing of a lifetime friend. Lord, save us, we cry with Peter. An incident comes to my mind, and it occurred very early in my teaching career. It may seem so trivial now, but at the time in my life, it was not. I was living in another province. I was more or less desperate at the time for a teaching position. And as a result, I accepted one as a French teacher. Yes, I did have a study of the language in university, but I had not achieved fluency in speaking. Once I got the position, I realized that I felt inadequate teaching the language, although I was not receiving any negative feedback. I struggled with it for a long time, and finally I made my decision to resign. I was in over my head, I felt. I felt such a failure so early in my career to have to give up a position. I found out after, though, that I could have stayed and had been offered a different one, but at that time I did not realize it. The rough waters got me in this situation, but God was there to reassure me that my life was not over. With a word and a touch, Jesus reassures Peter of his presence and the power of God to alter reality. Jesus saves him in his weak moment, but not without reminding him of the importance of keeping the faith. We hold the same promise of God's amazing grace in our weak moments and in our failings. We too are to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus and not the gushing wind and the swelling waves that surround us and so often overwhelm us. Even if Peter did not succeed in this case, he was willing to step out in faith and try. We know that Jesus named Peter the Rock for a reason. Jesus calls him the foundation on which the church would be built. From this story, we learn once again that our loving God, our Creator and Redeemer, is always present with a community of believers in times of crisis. Over the past 5 months, people all over the world have been experiencing torrential waves with this pandemic. We have been faced with all kinds of challenges, including how to do our ministries. We are missing the gathering of the community. And come this fall, when we reopen our churches for services, it will look differently and seem strange with the spacing and other limitations. But in the meantime, the waves did not stop us. God is with us all the way. We are recording services, we're meeting in different ways, and we have phone ministries to keep in touch. This story today concludes with Jesus and Peter getting in the boat, the storm subsiding, and the other disciples celebrating another miracle of Jesus. Here in this space and in this time, the human and the holy bond, and the world is changed by another encounter. God calls us to come and walk by faith, and eyes fixed steadfastly on him, and experience our own special encounters with Jesus our Lord. When we fail, as we inevitably will, he will surely raise us up and draw us to himself. And in those moments, let us worship him as the disciples said, did. Truly, you are the Son of God. Amen. Let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Then we will move to our intercessions and thanksgiving prayers.
For our intercessions this morning, we'll use Litany number 1, found on page 110 of the Book of Alternative Services. In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For peace from on high and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Today in our Tridiocesan intercessions, we pray for the parish of Pooch Cove, the rector, the Reverend Emmeline Coffin Strickland, with congregation at Pooch Cove. We also pray for the parish of Torbay, the rector, the Reverend Eric Squires, with congregation at Torbay. In our Anglican Communion of Prayer, we pray for the province of the Anglican Church of Rwanda, the Most Reverend Laurent Mbanda, Archbishop of the Anglican Church of Rwanda, and the Bishop of Shiria. For our bishops and for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Elizabeth, our Queen, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
for this town of Clarendon, for the surrounding communities and towns, for every city and community, and for those who live in them in faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For good weather, for abundant harvest, for all to share, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who travel by land, water, or air, for the sick and the suffering, especially remembering today Mildred, Dana, Edna, Florence, Janice, Marjorie, Selena, Lynn, Courtney, Elaine, Alonzo, Mitchell, Dale, Roy, Evelyn, Daryl, Nicole, Nancy, Dennis, Leah, and Janet, for prisoners and captives, for their safety, health, and salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our deliverance from all affliction, strife, and need, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the absolution and remission of our sins and offenses, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remembering all the saints, we commit ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord.
Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications to you, and you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together, you will hear their requests. Fulfill now our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, eternal life. For you, Father, are good and loving, and we glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. I invite you to turn with me to page 129 as we pray together the second Thanksgiving prayer. It starts in the middle of the page. Accept, O Lord, our thanks and praise for all you have done for us. We thank you for the splendor of the whole creation, for the beauty of this world, for the wonder of life, and for the mystery of love. We thank you for the blessing of family and friends, and for the loving care which surrounds us on every side. We thank you for setting us tasks which demand our best efforts, and for leading us to accomplishments which satisfy and delight us. We thank you also for those disappointments and failures that lead us to acknowledge our dependence on you alone. Above all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for the truth of his word and the example of his life, for his steadfast obedience by which he overcame temptation, for his dying through which he overcame death, for his rising to life again, in which we are raised to the life of your kingdom. Grant us the gift of your Spirit, that we may know Christ and make him known, and through him, at all times and in all places, may give thanks to you in all things. Amen. I invite you to please turn to page 372. As we pray together the prayer over the gifts. God, our sustainer, accept all we offer you this day and feed us continually with that bread which satisfies all hunger, your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And on page 373, we'll pray the collect. Almighty God, you sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and light of your church. Open our hearts to the riches of your grace, that we may bring forth the fruit of the Spirit in love, joy, and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our closing hymn
is What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Once again, thanks to Iris and to Paul and Charlene for helping out today, and thanks to those who worshiped and joined us today in our worship. We enjoy your brief comments. It's encouraging to know that we have a congregation, even though we are not in each other's presence. We will conclude our service with the dismissal. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And may the Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face shine on us and be gracious to us. The Lord look upon us with favor and grant us peace. Amen. Thank you again. Have a good week in the Lord and stay safe.